In addition, the clinical data management system also provides executive decision support. Now, the executives need information about what are the trends, how is my average bed, you know, my bed turnaround, what is the average stay of a patient for certain diseases, what is the cost going to be, and what is the how many resources, how many supplies do I use, things like that. The clinical decision support is then for the clinicians. For example, a rule might be for a particular case, what are the kind of diseases, what are the kind of treatment, or also drug-to-drug and drug-allergy interactions. If a physician prescribes a new drug, that information would then be checked against the drug database and also checked against any other pharmaceuticals or any other drugs that is taken by the patient to make sure that there are not in any interactions or other problems coming up. So the clinical decision support relies on a knowledge base that includes the treatment protocols. For example, if a patient comes in with a heart attack, what is the typical protocol that is being followed? Is it go straight to, for example, cardiology? Is it go put straight or put under medication? What is the particular protocol? And there are actually different protocols depending sometimes on the individual hospitals. What works for best for that population based on certain guidelines and rules? But what is the most efficient and most effective way to treat those patients under that for that particular condition? There are also external knowledge databases required for drugs, for example. The new drugs coming in, out all the time. And then a lot of terminology and coding is actually in the core as well, because they are part of data dictionaries. All the procedure codes are changing regularly. Also, when we go from ICD-9 to ICD-10, all the procedure codes and all the diagnosis codes, they also maintained in the central data repository. Our next step is to look inside the clinical data management system and see what is the internal architecture of this component. We see different components, different parts, and let's start on the top left where the modalities are. The modalities are typically the input into this system, into the core, and these might be CT scanners, X-ray units, they might be EKG equipment, whatever on digital data has been, you know, is connected straight to the core. Now, typically, when that information is sent by a technologist to an archive image management system, the information is in most cases not directly stored in the image manager / database and the archive, but in most cases it is temporarily held in an input queue. You can see that in the second block, number 2. The input queue allows a technologist to do any QA or QC. For example, in the case of a chest X-ray, the technologist might want to check whether the image has to be flipped, whether there's any collimation needs to, any shuttering needs to be applied, whether the image quality is okay. In the case of a CT scan, the technology might check that whether or not all the images are available, whether any of the reconstruction or 3D images are available as well. Anyway, the QA/QC step will determine whether an exam is complete and can be proceeded to the next workflow step, which is looking at the information and interpreting it. So, assuming that the information is approved, is verified by a technologist, which actually also can happen through an input by the RIS, by the radiology or the cardiology information system. But anyway, assuming that it is verified, then the fifth component called workflow manager will come into play. The workflow manager is nothing else than a job scheduler. It takes all the data, all the new data to be interpreted, and it divides them over little buckets, so to speak, depending on who's going to do what. In a typical department, there might be, for example, a generalist, a general radiologist that reads all of the information, but it's not that common. In many cases, there are radiologists that only read nuclear medicine, or there are radiologists that typically like to do only chest, or there are radiologists that only look at MRIs. And so actually, there could be multiple physicians that are part of one specialty. There could be two or three chest radiologists. The workflow manager keeps track of who's doing what and making sure that there's no double reads, so that no two physicians report on the same study. The workstation will then communicate back with the workflow manager when information is completed and when a report is generated and so on. A seventh component we see in the top right is the remote viewing. The remote viewing is the capability for physicians, practitioners, specialists to have access to the data. In many cases, they want to have access to the reports, but also sometimes to the images as well. Number eight is the system console on the top, on the bottom left, and this is a critical piece of the overall system. Not necessarily just the data entry, the computer, but the functionality is important. The system console will provide the tools for a system administrator to do whatever he or she needs to do to maintain the data integrity of the system. And the data integrity of the system might have to be maintained, for example, by merging studies, by deleting certain images, by merging patients, by completing studies that were not completed, and by reconciling different patient IDs, and on and on and on and on. In addition, a lot of statistics and a lot of reporting needs to be, from an operational perspective, needs to be run so that somebody can watch the increase in storage capacity by different departments, by different modalities, and things like that. So the system console and the features and the functions to manage this critical component is this really important part of the overall system. And in many cases, it's actually overlooked. Number nine will be the HL7 feed. The HL7 feed, for example, could be used to verify studies, making sure that the status of a study is completed. That means it can be read or interpreted. The HL7 feed can also be used for study content notification. And for example, when a patient has arrived or new orders, all that information, whatever is needed in the core, will be coming from the departmental systems and be fed into the core. Similarly, will be the XDS feed, which is in the box number 10. This is really the cross-enterprise document sharing and also imaging sharing. And that, because it's called cross-enterprise, that means it can actually exchange information between different enterprises, between different DHE systems. And that happens with the standard XDS, XDSI, XDSB, and so on. And then the 11th component, the master patient index, which we do not necessarily only need for the enterprise, because in the enterprise you might have a different patient identifier for the lab as for radiology and for cardiology, but even more importantly, we need that when we again collect data from different enterprises. What are some of the most important generic requirements for the DHE? First of all, the DHE, the core, the digital healthcare enterprise, really serves the enterprise. And that's a major shift from prior implementations, where we really were focusing on one department, such as radiology or cardiology or dentistry or the GI department or whatever the department was, or radiation therapy or ultrasound or nuclear medicine. They were all their little islands, and now we're really finding a solution for the total enterprise. Instead of serving the individual ologies each individually. So we need to make sure that this can serve the complete enterprise, and then in addition deal with multiple IDs, multiple patient IDs, which could be both in-house, Because, for example, if you want to look at a lab test, the patient might be identified in the laboratory system with a different patient ID. But also external, when a CD comes in with patient information, the patient will very likely be identified with a different patient identifier. When we want to request information from an outpatient clinic that belongs to a different provider group or a different enterprise, we need to be able to deal with multiple identifiers. Another requirement is that we really need to have a simple migration. The migration will be from different vendors for the different departmental systems. So if we go with another cardiology PACS vendor, with a different radiology PACS vendor, when we change the vendors in the nuclear medicine, the migration of the data should be very simple, and there should be any loss of data integrity. The enterprise system also should be ultimately very scalable. There should not be any limits. For example, if, as I've seen in the past, that if a database exceeds 1 million members, that suddenly the information gets really slow, or sometimes they get some issues. So it needs to be scalable to be able to provide a solution for the enterprise and grow with the enterprise. It also needs to be hardware independent. So if you change your disk drives or your vendor, that should be totally transparent and technology independent. Whether we use a SAN today or a NAS tomorrow or grid or cloud archiving next year, that all should not have any impact on the overall DHE system. Now let's talk a little bit about how the potential definition of the DHE system could look like, and part of the definition we will then deduct all the different requirements for this system. So let's start with the definition. So a DHE solution is a medical device that provides a scalable image and information and lifecycle management. This will allow images and related information to be queried, stored, and then retrieved in a manner that is defined by open standards, which is critical. And it has to be at a multiple department, enterprise, and even regional, so beyond the department and the enterprises level. And we want to maintain patient privacy and security. We want to make sure that the information is only seen by the people that is supposed to be seen. So we need to have a role-based access, right? And different roles based on the role, whether it's your primary physician, whether it's another physician, we need to make sure that we have the appropriate privacy and security roles into place. The second part of the definition is a little bit about the characteristics, and it is that it provides a patient-centric approach that we talked about. So it transcends upgrades. That means when the system is upgraded, that will not impact any of the capabilities or functionality, and also changes. And what could change? The different viewing, acquisition, and workflow management components. So whether we have different acquisition systems, when a new modality comes in, whether we have different viewing station, or the workflow management, the workflow manager, or the core of the archive as well. And they should all be interchangeable, plug and play, without having to migrate the data, convert the data, or change the data formats, or even changing the interfaces. So this has to do with the approach as well as potential changes. We need to make sure that it's a completely open system that allows different components to be able, to be able to plug and play and really to be upgraded and changed independently.